Kenyan President William Ruto vows to uphold the rule of law amid protests demanding his resignation. But he also announced plans for deep spending cuts after withdrawing a contested finance bill, which included unpopular tax hikes. At least 25 people have died in clashes with police over the past 2 weeks. Activists have issued calls for further strikes and civil disobedience unless Ruto quits, accusing him of failing to protect Kenyans. Ruto condemns the loss of life, but says he must also protect the innocent from those taking advantage of the unrest. Turning now to the elections in France, the far-right National Rally Party wins the first round of the parliamentary election. Exit polls show the RN winning 34% of the vote, ahead of leftist and centrist rivals, including President Emmanuel Macron's Together Alliance, which finished a distant third. The RN's chances of winning power next week will depend on days of horse trading before the runoff.
It's a historic result. The National Rally has never had a candidate elected in the first round of the legislative election, and today, several dozens of candidates have been elected in the first round. I think all of this is an element of great hope for millions of French people.
Tonight's lesson is that the far right is on the doorstep of power. Never before in our democracy has the National Assembly risked being dominated by the far right as it was tonight. And so, our objective is clear: to prevent the National Rally from having an absolute majority in the second round, from dominating the National Assembly, and therefore from governing the country with its disastrous project.
In the past, center-right and center-left parties have teamed up to keep the far-right from power. But that dynamic is less certain than ever. Macron now calling for a broad alliance as he urges voters to rally behind candidates who are clearly Republican and Democratic. Protests break out in France after exit polls show the National Rally leading the first round of parliamentary elections. Protesters in Paris chanted slogans against the far right and carried banners denouncing them as the mortal enemy of the LGBT community. Some are also denouncing the RN's anti-immigrant policies. Hundreds also marching in the French city of Nantes against the possibility of the far right taking power. A longtime pariah, the RN is now closer to power than ever. Marine Le Pen has sought to clean up the image of the party known for racism and anti-Semitism, a tactic that has worked amid voter anger against Emmanuel Macron. Hurricane Beryl barreling across the Atlantic Ocean towards the Caribbean, where it is expected to bring life-threatening winds and flash floods. The first hurricane of the 2024 season was located about 400 kilometers southeast of Barbados Sunday afternoon, with maximum sustained winds of 215 kilometers per hour. The center of the hurricane is expected to travel across the Windward Islands Monday morning as a Category 4 storm, the second strongest level on a five-step scale. It is rare for a major hurricane to appear this early in the Atlantic hurricane season, which runs from June 1 to November 30. Beryl is now the earliest Category 4 hurricane on record, beating Hurricane Dennis, which became a Category 4 on July 8, 2005. Over in Switzerland, flooding and landslides kill at least 4 people. 2 more remain missing. Police say 3 of the victims were killed in the remote Magia Valley after violent thunderstorms and melting snow caused landslides. The Rhone River also overflowed, triggering floods and displacing hundreds. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
We begin with 48 million viewers tuning in to watch CNN's presidential debate across broadcast and cable news. Thursday night's face-off between President Joe Biden and former President Donald Trump became the most watched non-sports program of the year to date, according to Nielsen. The showdown between the two oldest presidential candidates in U.S. history caused some concerns for the Democratic Party as the 81-year-old Biden delivered rambling answers. His campaign blamed it on a cold. Biden's voice was weak early in the debate, and he was losing his train of thought on some issues, including the economy. 78-year-old Trump, though perceived to have delivered his points across with more energy and passion, was accused of spewing lies and misstatements on a variety of topics, including abortion, his recent criminal conviction, and his Democratic rival's immigration record. Like many voters, Republican Beatrice Schakel is still weighing her options.
I stand behind my party, and I saw when former President Trump was president, the good that he did economically. But I personally, as a person, as an individual, I don't feel the most comfortable, just him leading and his attitudes and character traits, especially being a woman and being a minority, that kind of turns me off.
A YouGov poll shows that Trump won the debate. But independent voter Genevieve Santiago, a New Hampshire resident, is leaning towards voting for Biden despite his shaky performance.
I was a little disappointed on both sides. I was upset that Biden really showed his age. I thought this was a really good time for him to show, like, he's confident, he has power, and he understands what's going on. He had a couple fumbles, but I think he did all right overall.
Like many independent voters, she says she could still be convinced to vote for Trump.
If Trump presented an actual plan and was a little less negative about everything and started talking about how he was going to get us out of whatever issues he believes that we're suffering with right now, then maybe I could back him.
And finally in sports, a Filipino-American is getting his shot with an NBA team. After going undrafted in the 2024 NBA draft, USC guard Boogie Ellis has signed with the Sacramento Kings. Ellis managed to impress scouts at the G League Elite Camp and earned an invitation to the NBA Draft Combine. Last year, as a fifth-year senior, the San Diego native averaged 16.5 points per game for the USC Trojans on 42.7% field goal shooting. Ellis began his college career with 2 years at Memphis winning an NIT championship and the ACC Sixth Man of the Year in 2021. He now joins a young Kings team that hired former PBA and Gilas legend Jimmy Alapag as an assistant coach last year. Meanwhile, after going undrafted in the 2024 NBA draft, Filipino-American shooting guard Jared Lucas will be joining the defending Western Conference champions Dallas Mavericks for the NBA Summer League. Lucas spent his first three college seasons playing at Oregon State before spending 2 years at Nevada. As a fifth-year senior, Lucas averaged just under 18 points per game last year.
And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.